I won't be speaking in Chinese today. Often these days, when we make things, we put our work in progress out on the internet for all to see. Even sometimes when it's just sketches, we'll post it to get feedback, to get social affirmation about what we're doing. We live in a time of unprecedented transparency with open data, open source, the lean startup movement, and the rise of social networks and online platforms that allow for communication instantaneously and great visibility. This can be used to create accountability that is particularly important in government and nonprofit organizations, and even in for-profits to create trust. The other reason that transparency is important, and what will be the focus of my talk today, is participation. Whether that's engaging with people in real life or displaying our test results for all to see. I'll talk about transparency in code with open source, in business with lean startup, and how both of these involve community and how we can use open practices and be transparent in the development of a community. I believe, as others who've spoken here in the past, that open source is the path to enlightenment. In Ruby, especially, we believe that programmer happiness is a worthwhile pursuit, that coding itself can be joyful, regardless of the outcome. But the focus of my talk today is about when we create software where the goal is for other people to use it, when our software empowers people after it is released in the world, and how to use transparency in order to increase participation, how and why to involve people in the making of change, in creating the world that we'd like to be. We can't just make things for people. We have to make them with people. So participation accelerates learning. And so we're going to take a moment and get you all participating and learning something. So some of you might have been out late last night doing karaoke, or drinking with your new friends, so this will maybe wake you up. We have many people who in the audience speaks both English and Chinese. A few people. Who speaks only Chinese? Just a few people. Who speaks only English? Okay, everybody else, what do you speak? I think maybe we have some people still sleeping. So, during my talk and up until lunch, you can tweet any phrase, your favorite phrase, or some phrase that strikes your fancy in English or Chinese, and at mention Mightyverse and the hashtag RubyConfTW, or as I like to think of it, RubyConf for the win. So you have an opportunity not only to learn a little bit of the other language, because we have volunteers standing by who will help translate from one language to the other. And my friend Judy Chuan will be tweeting out the a shared Google spreadsheet, so anybody who is bilingual can help with the translation. So we will help you learn a little bit of another language. And you have the opportunity to win a game, Dígame, if you are somebody learning Spanish. And if you are somebody learning English, I have a prototype of the English game. So this is a sort of meta level of transparency, and I'll talk about the game development later. So then tweet at Mightyverse, hashtag RubyConfTW, and any phrase you like that you want to learn, and then you can use it to speak to each other in the rest of the conference. So participation. I have found that participation creates better outcomes. You end up with higher quality and less waste. We're able to create dramatically better products at less cost. And it can seem like it takes more time to engage people while you're in the process of making. But what we found, many people have found, not just me, is that it actually accelerates the pace of development. And I'll talk about that in a bit. But first, I want to talk about one of the most important things to think about in creating a transparent process and in communicating what you're doing. The most important thing is to communicate your intention. So the other day, we went to the National Palace Museum, and which houses this painting. And I think this is a good illustration of expressing a vision of where you're going and the path to get there. And this allows people to come with you and follow that path. Now, of course, when we're doing software, generally we don't make epic paintings to show people the way, although I would love to see that for some of your open source projects. But in thinking about how to think about goals and small steps, I like to look at the gaming world. This is the game of StarCraft, a particular game of Boxer versus Yellow. Boxer maneuvers his Marines and keeps them from being hit while taking out the opponent's units. In this small skirmish, Boxer displays amazing micro skills, but even novice players often win in these small situations. And these small wins give them confidence, hope, and a vision about how they're going to win the bigger battles. But in StarCraft, you're not just fighting random aliens for the heck of it all over the universe. You are fighting for control of the galaxy. In a more advanced game, you can see that both sides have built up very large armies. Boxer wins, and his opponent has left the game. Blizzard does a fabulous job of inspiring people to pursue an epic win. I really like how Jane McGonigal, in her TED Talk, talks about epic win. It was through this TED Talk that I learned about the photos of Toledano, where he took photos of gamers and their intense emotions as they play games. And she suggested that this is an expression when somebody is about to experience the epic win. She describes this epic win as an extraordinary outcome that you didn't believe was even possible until you achieved it, almost beyond your threshold of imagination, something that teaches you what you are truly capable of. She says that gamers always believe that an epic win is possible, and that is always worth trying, and worth trying now. And I think, as we seek to encourage people to participate in our projects, we have the opportunity to give people that insight, that inspiration of the epic win. So I will talk about this in three areas: in the development of a community, in the development of a business, and in writing code. So first, I'll talk about community. About 6 years ago, I co-founded RailsBridge. which is now a global organization, which grew into Bridge Foundry, but I co-founded it with Sarah May, and it started out with a simple workshop format. We thought we could create more diversity in the Ruby on Rails community, local in San Francisco, if we held a workshop and invited women to come learn and included men in this outreach. And we had overwhelming response and found that we could accept over 80 students by finding 8 volunteer teachers and dozens of volunteers. The success of RailsBridge and the Ruby community in San Francisco was in large part due to the help we received from the community. Companies offered space and sponsored food, and everyone with skills offered to teach. RailsBridge is a great example of open source processes, not just open source documentation and open source code. It's focused on what is a widening gender gap in tech. This chart shows the gap in women receiving computer science degrees in the United States. And we see similar patterns in the commercial software industry. However, in open source, the gap is much wider, with only 2 to 3% of contributors who are women. Now, this is a little odd because we know that the first programmers were women. In the early days, at least in the United States, the field of software development was created by women. Our epic win is to create a time in the future where people work together regardless of gender or ethnicity in numbers equivalent to their representations in society. We demonstrated these results at a small scale that caused people to believe that our epic win was possible, and that individuals taking the small step of teaching a weekend workshop could make that happen. We wanted to structure an organization that would support this enthusiasm, this outpouring of volunteer support. And our goal was to let nothing get in the way of someone creating a workshop. At the time I read this book, The Starfish and the Spider, which greatly influenced how I helped shepherd this all-volunteer organization, it has the tagline, "The Unstoppable Power of Leaderless Organizations." And I wanted this organization to be unstoppable. The metaphor of the book's title comes from the spider, that if you chop off its head, it dies. But some starfish, if you chop them in half, you get 2 starfish. So I thought, wow, we could create this starfish organization that just, the more people who are involved, you can separate them and they'll just make more workshops and make more of this phenomenon, this movement. One of the stories I was particularly inspired by was about the Apache tribe that in the Americas, and they had a system of government where they were led by, instead of a chief, it was what they called a nantan, who was a spiritual and cultural leader. And the way that these leaders were chosen is that anybody could at any time decide to follow a new spiritual leader, and tribes would come together and tribes would separate based on leaders emerging in the community. So when the Spanish and English settlers came and attacked the Apache, all it took was one person to have the idea of, instead of being settled and farming as they had been all over regions of North America, one of the Apache decided, well, we could be nomadic and we could hunt. And a whole lot of Apaches followed him, and then they survived where other tribes did not because of their system of government and how they chose leaders. So RailsBridge grew all over the world. This map was made a couple of years ago, and there should be even more dots now in over 50 cities. And what I realized is we were not leaderless. This book is misnamed. We were leaderful. And what I realized we needed to do was to make apparent how people came into these leadership roles. I read this essay by an American feminist, Jo Freeman, called The Tyranny of Structurelessness. And that's a mouthful, but she wrote it during the rise of feminism in the 70s. And she said, there's no such thing as a structureless group. If you think your group has no structure, it actually has a hidden structure. There are ways that decisions happen, but they are not clear to outsiders or newcomers. And I didn't want our group to be like this, but I kept hearing from people, despite all of our processes being documented, that they didn't know how to get started. So I was talking about this challenge with one of our spiritual leaders, Rachel Myers, and she just spontaneously came up with this idea. Maybe she thought about it for a long time, I don't know, but one day I saw this repo up here on GitHub and her announcement with this idea that people could just create an issue for a workshop that they wanted to organize and or host. Her idea was that the title of the issue would have the workshop location and date, but she didn't say we should do this. She said, it's awesome if. She left space for people to have different ideas or post a workshop that didn't yet have a date or a location. And people elaborated on this, and it grew. And a year and a half later, this has been in active use. The instructions now make it clear that anyone can make a workshop. It just must be free, must be an outreach workshop to some underrepresented community, must have a code of conduct, and everything else is open to innovation. You can see that there are 11 open issues at the time of this screenshot, which are 11 workshops that were in the planning stage. And we also have a pull request. Now, I just want to take a sidebar for a moment and talk about pull requests. Now, I love pull requests. But there's also a dark side to the pull request mechanism. It's really the dark side of open source. I think it's really important to understand what some people call a false meritocracy. And I like to call the tyranny of the pull request. There's a power structure implied by the pull request mechanism. You have one person or a group of people who are the committers, and they have the rights to decide what goes in and what goes out. And this is a platform where hidden biases emerge with no clear intention, with people not meaning to do wrong or to act in ways that are unfair. In fact, often they think they are being completely fair. They just hold different people to different standards. Some pull requests might get merged right away. They know that guy. He's a good guy. His code's usually good. I'm going to give it a cursory look and hit merge. Whereas other people, I don't know them, you know. I have to look in more detail. And maybe I don't think about it, but I don't really like the color of their avatar. And that makes me look closer and criticize more, or not get around to looking at their pull request for a couple days or a few weeks. So we have to be attentive to this, and I believe that transparency is the antidote to this false meritocracy. We each have the opportunity and the responsibility to create a different kind of open source society by making it transparent what is possible. So it's been exciting to see that we've been somewhat successful at creating a transparent organization with RailsBridge. We believe this still can be improved, yet we've seen MobileBridge start up last year. They replicated the idea from RailsBridge and made their own organizing repo, And then this summer, after I gave a similar talk at MagmaConf, William Kennedy started up GoBridge, and they had their first workshop in August. So when you are transparent about your intention and your processes, that liberates people to do the things in keeping with what you want to see happen. So I'm going to shift now to the world of business. And how can we be open where we're trying to make money and we don't want to necessarily share all the things with all the people, and what makes sense there? I followed the practice of Lean Startup, which has a different kind of transparency. It encourages techniques of experimentation, which, because they're about your business, of necessity have to be in public. I like Steve Blank's definition of a startup as an organization formed to search for a repeatable and scalable business model. And while you're on that search, transparency increases the speed of learning. It increases the speed at which you can define a successful business, because learning faster helps you make better decisions, decreases risk, and decreasing risk reduces cost. So I'm going to share a story of my startup, Mightyverse, which has a social mission. Almost 50% of the world's languages are endangered. One goes extinct every 2 to 3 weeks in the world. So we have this idea of an epic win, which is not just to make it easy to document an endangered language, but to shift the value system that is the dominant narrative that says that we should all just speak the same language. Wouldn't it be easy if everybody learned English or everybody learned Chinese? Well, I have to tell you, even if we all at this moment decided to speak the exact same language and we could somehow instantaneously all be speaking the same language, we would inevitably develop local customs and local changes of language that would cause us in a generation to all be speaking different languages again. We need to, I believe, embrace the diversity of language and culture, because learning somebody else's language helps you understand their experience. And if you understand somebody else's experience, you can actually communicate with them. And that would be this epic win. There are over 6,000 languages in the world. The majority of them are spoken by a tiny fraction of the population. There's almost 80% of the world speaks only 83 languages. So we have this model where endangered languages will always be free, and we could have the big languages fund the little languages and support the valuable diversity on our planet. So I'll share with you a little story of how we got, of how we started. The company started all top secret, with everything, you know, sort of classic, old school startup, where everything was developed in secret with you know, private betas. And I joined the team and said, I really like this lean startup approach. Let's get it out there. And so this was what our first website looked like. It was not even what they call a minimally viable product, an MVP, because it didn't really implement our business. It just took these little video phrases that we had and made them public on the internet and let us engage with our prospective customers. So this was up for a little while we were continuing to develop our core product. And I noticed that it didn't really have that much search traffic, which wasn't really a goal, but I kind of expected that after a little press and we had some links in, it would get search traffic over time. And then I realized this obvious thing, which, you know, maybe some of you have experienced, which is that we had this wonderful, like, in-page responsive thing, and the way that you got to our phrases was through the search box. So effectively, we'd hidden this great content database from Google and the other search engines. So we made a small change, where we created a page for each phrase. So suddenly our site had 26,000 pages, and we saw that as they got indexed, our traffic went up. And our traffic has continued to rise year over year without, even in years that we don't add a significant amount of content. I believe that website traffic is like unit tests. Just because all your unit tests pass doesn't mean your app works. And just because your website has traffic, you can have a very popular website, still not have a business. But it's a good asset to have, it's a good thing to do first, and so while we're working on the rest of our business, our traffic continues to grow. So the next step is to make an engaging product. So I believe that the best way to do this is by getting people in our target audience to participate in the act of creation. We're creating a community and also software, but the software's a facilitator of the community. The community's actually a thing that exists outside of the software. It's relationships between people that might have met because of our software and because of our company, but it's a living, breathing entity independent of the software that we can develop in parallel with developing the software. And this isn't unique to Mightyverse at all. Every piece of software, I think, that's on the web today has a community. Every mobile app, there's a group of people using it, and often they're interacting in your app. And if they're not interacting in your app, they're interacting on forums where they're asking for help with your app. Or they, whether they're on your website or somebody else's, they're interacting with each other on the internet. And there's an opportunity to really develop that group of people and serve them and have them collaborate with you. So I think that the best way to do this when you're doing new product design is with a paper prototype. It's best because it's fast. I also believe that the low fidelity nature of this kind of prototype makes people more comfortable giving feedback. It accelerates learning. We need to always be learning, and of course, learning from our audience is just part of it. There's all sorts of great ways that we can and should learn about the software that we're building or the software that we need to build. So when we were building Mightyverse, most recently, we started with this idea at the very beginning that it was going to be this language learning utility. But more and more, we thought we wanted it to be fun. We wanted it to be game-like. We wanted to make that experience that we got excited by speaking with somebody for the first time. We wanted to somehow spark that with our software. So we learned about board game design, which at first I thought was like maybe very different from what I thought we should be doing. But one of my partners was really passionate about this talk by Matt Leacock about board game design, and I kind of went with it. And didn't think that I learned that much when I first saw it. But as we continued to develop paper prototypes, I realized that I was using these techniques from board game design in doing a paper prototype for our mobile app. And our first paper prototype, you did markers and cards. And we envisioned that these would be things that were proxies for what you did on your mobile device. And I want to talk a moment about experimenting with paper and some of the techniques that really work for that. I really believe that you need to iterate on paper till it works on paper. It feels really goofy at first to like hold up your piece of paper and have people point at it, and you can feel it can be very uncomfortable. But you realize that you're actually just communicating with a human, and that they can see things in your design, and if you need to make a change, it's really easy to crumple it up and draw a new one and say, how does that work? So it's really important to just iterate on it. We call it play testing, which I think is a lot more fun than usability testing. We always prepare for the unexpected and give yourself the space to really learn something new, to notice something and reinvent your app or your game a lot in between these playtest sessions. So We started playing with friends and family that were learning Spanish, because Spanish is one of the languages that I speak. And sometimes in the middle of a game, I would just throw away a card and make up a new one and keep playing. And this was really helpful for the design process, which at first was clearly very much a design process for our mobile app. But we started to realize that two things. One is that this could kind of work as a card game that didn't have to be a mobile app to do the beginner learning bits of the language. And of course, you'd run out of phrases after a while when you ran out of cards, but the game was really working. At the same time, we realized that there were a lot of elements of the game that weren't working, and we'd have to do a lot of these play tests, and we were kind of running out of the people we happened to know who were learning Spanish in our neighborhood. So we decided to employ this technique of doing an Indiegogo campaign. And I want to highlight this because crowdfunding campaigns are a fabulous way to engage with prospective customers. If somebody will pay you money for your idea before it exists, they are incredibly valuable, and they probably are an amazing sample of your target customers. Or they're your mom, which is also cool. My mom was the first person to contribute to our campaign. But it also turned into a great way. We thought we had run out of all the people we knew who were learning Spanish. As soon as you're doing a crowdfunding campaign, like, this is what you talk about over lunch. What are you up to, Sarah? Well, last weekend I was putting together a crowdfunding campaign. You tell everybody you know, and suddenly, I knew 10 times as many people learning Spanish that I had no idea were learning Spanish. So, and then we expanded it to learn Japanese as well. So, with this campaign, two things. One is, which I think is something that I remember learning in my when I was first doing software, working with a real marketing department, that one of the techniques in product management in the old days is to actually make an advertisement for your product before it exists, to help understand the market and to help the engineers really understand where you're going with the thing. And that's what a crowdfunding campaign is. It's an advertisement for your product before it exists. So, but in doing so, we also had a commitment to make the actual card game, which was a hard decision for us because we're not really a card game company, and we don't think that's a scalable business model. But we decided that we needed a lot of time to do this play testing and that this was the way to find people. So we thought it would take a few months. It took most of a year. But now you can buy Digame on Amazon. It's an actual card game. And people buy it every day. It's really astounding. And what we found is that what we were learning was not about the design of a mobile app. What we learned is our business is about helping people communicate across language, right? Which we always said, but we thought about it as a software business. But this expanded our notion of what we're trying to do. We're trying to make change in the world, and software is the means to make that change scalable. So I'm absolutely passionate about figuring out how to make that change happen at a small scale with a few people in order to understand the transformation that you're trying to create. So this year we went back to working on our mobile app. This was actually an early vision of our mobile app from the year before. And this design looks lovely, but it doesn't actually work for any real use case. So we decided to take the approach of building just a little bit of the app and having a play test with every increment. So this seems to be a lot slower, but it saves us from releasing something and having it fall flat with the audience. So our current app is just a few screens. This is probably the third major iteration of this app that lets you record a phrase in one language and cross-translate it to another language, which doesn't even have all the elements of gameplay that we plan to do, but we can get people to use the app and start to understand the interactions that happen when people are doing this activity. It's very hard to get people to use the app when you know it's not ready. Not only does it not have the features that I think are going to make it fun, but it also has bugs. And every time I look at the app, all I can see are the bugs that I know are there. Now, one of the adages from Lean Startup is that an MVP, a minimally viable product, is not a half-baked cake. It's a cupcake. How do you envision a small version of your product that is complete? And when I think about software with known bugs in it, it doesn't feel complete. When I think about all the rough edges, it doesn't feel like a cupcake. It feels a little half-baked. And so I really struggle with that. But they also say that an MVP should be the smallest possible thing that you can learn from. And what would I be learning while I fix those bugs? Maybe I'm going to get a little better at iOS development, but I'm not going to be learning anything about my target customer. If, you know, 1 out of 20 people can't successfully authenticate, then I can work around it if I'm sitting next to them. But I'm not, if I'm fixing that bug, I'm not really learning what the next step of my app is. One of the things that I learned when I became a mom, I read a lot. I was very nervous about parenting, and I read every single book there was, and I found that a lot of the experts conflicted with each other. And who's a parent in the room? Anybody? A few people have kids. But what I decided was I could just pick the experts that I wanted to listen to and do what I thought was right. So similarly, I'm hearing conflicting stories by other experts about what to do with my MVP and when I should do what. So I made up my own framework. The playtest itself is a game. So this is a game that I play, and I made up some rules. The first rule is from Matt Leacock, who did the board game talk, which is shut up and watch. The point is to learn from the people playing my app, using my app. Also, take notes. You forget stuff right afterwards. Take photos. There are things that you miss in the moment. Resist providing answers and instead ask questions. This is a magical thing. So when somebody runs into that bug that I know is there, I see them about to press that button and I'm cringing inside going, oh, they're gonna find that bug. And my first instinct when they go, huh, is to say, oh, that's a bug. But what I've learned, the better thing to do is to say, what did you expect would happen? And sometimes what they say is not the thing that I was planning to build. So I've just saved myself all that development time. I can build something different that matches their expectation. It's amazing. So it's really, really hard at first to just watch. You can see me, I'm like biting my lip there. It's hard to resist saying something, watching my friend struggle using the app. The other thing is if you play test, you want to play test your first raw app experiences with people who, either you have like a huge access to your target audience, or you play test with your friends who will still play your app the next time. So then, as the session goes on, I start to learn things. I start to be curious, and I see things that I don't expect, and it starts to be fun. Just like playing a game, I'm abiding by these rules, and I can sink myself into it and actually enjoy it. So here is a sequence of photos from a recent playtest. And you can see that this is at the end of a usability test session, and I feel like it's important to always give your usability test subjects cookies. Works out really well. And in this case, Ian and Judy started making up phrases about cookies and recording them, and it became part of the playtest. And at the end, in the last segment, it's a little blurry on the screen, but if you can see it, Ian has this expression of delight. And it's not about the cookie. He's looking at the app, and he's delighted with this phrase that Judy has recorded. And that is the moment you're looking for. That moment where somebody is delighted with an experience that you have sparked, that you have helped create. And that is what you want to amplify and recreate in future designs of your app and future iterations, or things that you want to keep while you develop other things around your app. Learning together creates community, and you want that community to exist around your software. If you want to try our app, send email. Right now it's only on the iPhone. You can send email to feedback@mightyverse.com, and we'll add you to the beta, which is really an alpha, but they call it a beta with test flight. So for the last section of my talk, I'm going to shift gears and talk about code. What do we do and how do we approach it when we're writing code in the open? As a case study, I'm going to talk about this project that I've been working on for the last year called Open Opportunities, which uses the an open source project called Midas. So in my day job, I work for the United States government. Whenever I say that, I also have to say that I am not here speaking on behalf of the United States government. I'm here in my personal capacity, visiting you all, talking about all of my experiences. But I'm really delighted to share this amazing story about what is happening with this particular software and a movement in general in government open source and open processes. So first I'll tell you about what this software is. So Open Opportunities is this platform that whose goal it is to help federal workers work across teams and across agencies. We have a challenge in the United States. Our federal government has 2.7 million civilian employees. These employees are spread across hundreds of agencies. Some of these agencies themselves are hundreds of thousands of people with sub-institutes and agencies and centers in them. And so, of necessity, people's work is siloed. Some of this is the heritage of, you know, before the digital age, where people worked in buildings together and didn't have the opportunity to have people work with other buildings in different geographies, or just as a matter of focus on a particular area, they could only work with people in their group. But now, in the digital age, we have this opportunity to create collaboration across teams, and in fact, that type of collaboration is essential for solving the problems of our day. We have people in health and human services trying to address social issues and help sections of our society, and they would benefit from information that people at our housing and urban development agency know. And so the challenges in our society cross these agencies, and so we want to create ways for these people to work together. So this project was originally started using lean startup techniques inside the federal government on a WordPress blog. This was amazing woman, Lisa Nelson, created this way for people to just contact her when they had an opportunity. She'd put up a blog post with a button that said, "I'm in." Somebody would click that button and it would send her an email, and she would introduce people to each other and they would collaborate. And she found this to be very successful. And when it started to take off, she collaborated with my team at 18F, which is our team within the government, to create this newer platform that would automate a lot of these processes. So just like that WordPress platform, you go, you see an opportunity, you click, I'm in. But now no human has to be involved. People get introduced to each other and work together. So the epic win here is threefold. I'm going to talk mostly about the open source component of this because that's what affects most people here. But I think it's also interesting that we have our federal government using crowdsourcing techniques to have individuals on the ground help each other. And it's all in the service of the direct impact of these specific projects that individual government employees are creating in order to help our bigger society. And that's incredible. And what we're seeing is by fueling this with open source, not only are we creating a tool for our federal government, but it's a tool that can be used outside. And we're seeing nonprofits say, oh, well, this could be a way to organize our volunteers. This could be a way to get people to collaborate across our huge organization. And so we, the federal government, are creating something that can be used in wider society as well. So I'm going to talk about a few of the mechanisms that we use to make this work well. First, we have a contribution guide. Of course, many of you who run open source projects, this will be familiar to you. We have a really clear license. We put everything in the public domain. And we're clear about how we communicate. We have a Google group. We have stand-ups via Google Hangout. And there, we have a calendar that publishes when those stand-ups are. Any contributor can join our stand-ups. We have engineering discussions that are happening on Slack. And when we started this open source project and we started using Slack inside the federal government, we realized that we had to keep cross-posting the things in Slack and the things elsewhere. And so even though we documented all of this, we always had to remember to include our open source contributors. And then one of my colleagues found this great open source project called Slacken, which lets you put up a web form where people can put in their email and then they become a single channel contributor to Slack, which is a free part of Slack. And so now, any one of our open source contributors can just drop into our Slack channel and be in with the fray and do all the things that we do. And it's really pretty exciting. One of the things that makes this all happen, which is easy, I think, easier if you're an independent open source leader, but in the federal government, we had to create to document our license and our policies about how we do open source. And we weren't the first agency to do this. It's actually, a lot of agencies had done it before. I was surprised that our Department of Defense was one of the first agencies to have a clear open source license. A lot of their contractors use and create open source. Also, the Consumer Finance Protection Bureau is a relatively new agency in the United States where all of their software is open source. And one of the unique things that we do is instead of opening something up after the fact, which is common in government and in a lot of organizations where you make it good and then open it, right? It's sort of just like with the product development, it's kind of counterintuitive that you would put up an empty repo and make it public. I think GitHub has instigated this a little bit because the open repos are free, so people do that more often for that reason. But we do it as part of our practice, that from the first line of code, things are generally open. And revealing that work in progress, it can be scary, it makes you vulnerable, but it's an incredibly powerful thing. There's something that sort of happened over the last year or so is, and GitHub, you can have help wanted tags. And then there's different apps that aggregate those help wanted tags. Code for America will pull in help wanted tags. And so volunteers all over the United States are then finding our open source repo and just helping us out. It's kind of incredible. And then I've seen this be adopted outside of government as well. I don't exactly know where it started. I think that Code for America might have, but it's hard to see where these things start. But it's exciting to see when they latch on. they catch on. So many of the changes and the collaborations are those ones that you set out intentionally, right? You write an issue and you write down exactly how you want the behavior to be. You lay out your roadmap, and sometimes people come in and they do the thing. But it also allows for unexpected collaboration. So a couple of weeks ago, I was using our app, and I was working with a particular agency, and I went to the admin console and did a filter, and I realized, we don't actually display the number of things when they're filtered. And in theory, I could like export the spreadsheet and, you know, do all the things. And so it's probably not a very high priority bug, but I'm like, I bet it's on JavaScript on the page somewhere, right? But I'm like super busy doing something else this week. So I just filed a bug. As an admin, I'd like to see a count of users based on a filter. Because I was like, okay, we'll get to it later. It's not a priority right now. And then my colleague Dave tagged it, help wanted, because it's a pretty straightforward thing for somebody to do, and we just do that as a matter of course. And then a day after he put this tag on, somebody submitted a pull request. And one of my favorite quotes of all times, Dave Cole said, open source is magic. That there's a community of people who want to see this product happen. And I don't know whether this particular person wanted to see it happen because they are using this open source product for themselves, whether they're an American citizen who wants to help the government, or whether they're somebody learning Node.js and decided that they wanted to help with this software. It doesn't matter. When you open your projects, your hearts, your intentions, it allows for more people to participate and participate along the direction that you intend. Because if, in this case, this is not open source software for general use. We would be pleased if this software is used by people. But we're not going to change our roadmap in order to have it be used outside the government. We're being paid by our tax dollars. And we have a mission to provide software to the people that we're serving with this software. But if we're really clear about our roadmap, people can see whether it's useful to them. And then they know whether they're going to go look for something else or whether they're going to follow this path with us. So in closing, as you think about the software projects that you're involved with, whether they're open source, whether they're in your company, things that aren't software projects, community initiatives, the things you're doing with other people, imagine the epic win. What's the thing that's going to change the world, that's going to inspire people, and communicate that? But also identify the small steps that will get you there, the little wins that will get people excited, make them feel accomplished, and allow them to help out in a small way. Make your process visible, collaborate with your customers, your colleagues, the public, and through all these things, create opportunity for participation. And if you have a favorite phrase, don't forget to tweet at Mightyverse and RubyConf FW. TW. Thank you very much.
<音><音><音><音><音><音><音><音><音> Anybody got any questions to ask to Sarah? If you have any questions, please raise your hand. 如果有任何问题，我们欢迎你举手发问。 Okay.
Hey Sarah, have you already noticed that this transparency that you show helps you to get more people from minorities involved, like more women or more people of color, etc.?
Absolutely. There's been a tremendous amount of research that shows that what I've read is about women particularly, that women are more likely to be successful when a path is laid out, when it's clear what the rules are. There's a sobering book that I think is very well researched and a great book called Women Don't Ask. And this, the title of the book comes from these two women who noticed, they were working at a university, and they noticed that none of the teaching assistants were women. So they went to the dean and they said, why aren't any of the teaching assistants women? Why are you only giving these opportunities to men? And he said, well, no, I hadn't noticed that. But I really give, I mean, as long as somebody's in good standing, I give people the opportunity to anyone who asks. I guess women don't ask. And some people interpret this to mean that women lack self-confidence, and women, you know, don't step up for themselves. But I think, and I've observed, that sadly, when there isn't a clear path, there is often not actually a path open. That's where these hidden biases can come out. And so it's not that women who attempt to travel the path that is unspecified are often thwarted in ways that can't be seen by other people who would like to provide those opportunities equally. So that transparency is essential for getting people involved who frankly face so many stupid challenges in the world that why would they bother to follow to do things that aren't clearly laid out, because there's plenty of things, barriers that get in their way otherwise. So we've seen this being really, really effective with Rails Bridge and Bridge Foundry, and I've seen this also true when I was recruiting software engineers for the company that I used to run, Blazing Cloud, that by making it clear what our processes were for hiring, by engaging with the community, by being really transparent about our values and what we were trying to do in the world, that we grew to 20 people, and it was half women, half men, half software developers. We know whether they were software developers or designers or on business side, we had gender equality, which is not something that I was like carefully recruiting for. But I think being transparent about what the opportunity was at the company then allowed for that.
Any more questions? 还有其他任何人有问题吗？ 最后的机会哦。 Any more questions? 如果没有的话，那我们用掌声再来感谢我们的 Sarah Allen 的演讲，谢谢。 Well, thank you very much for your talk. And, oh, hold on, sorry.